So first of all, let me thank the organizers for giving me this big honor of presenting a plenary talk here at AIDS 2020. The title of my talk is Art 2020 Needs and Wants. These are my financial disclosures. In economical terms, something is a need when non-fulfillment might result in onset of disease or even death. 30 million people living with HIV taking antiretroviral therapy is the target that WHO and UNAIDS has established for 2020. And as of 2018, we were 7 million short of achieving that target. And comparing with the 2030 target, we are 10 million short of getting to the target. And because this is an extreme need, we are seeing the consequences of not achieving the target because we are not taking advantage of antiretroviral therapy as treatment, as prevention. We saw in 2018, 1.7 million new HIV infections. And worse even than that, we saw 0.8 million HIV-related deaths. So first and foremost, need to have access. But it's also very important, at least in low and middle income countries, to give antiretroviral therapy very rapidly. In this Cochrane Library meta-analysis, they look at clinical trials performed in middle and low income countries, looking at the strategy of starting ART rapidly, even the same day of diagnosis or usual care. And you can see in the slide that there was a statistically significant benefit, both in terms of mortality and in terms of achieving virologic control after 12 months of follow-up. So the first need, ART for everybody, and in low and middle income countries, because these studies have not been replicated in high income countries, start ART rapidly. Which ART to start? These are the recently updated European and DHHS guidelines, and you can see that there is agreement in the preferred first line regimens. Those are based on integrase inhibitors, dolutegravir, bictegravir, or raltegravir, along with two nucleosides. And for the first time in the history of HIV therapeutics, there is also a dual therapy recommended regimen with dolutegravir and a single nucleoside 3DC. The WHO, with its public health approach, recommends a regimen based on tenofovir difumarate plus either 3DC or FTC and dolutegravir. There are also other first line ART regimens that are considered not preferred but recommended or alternative, and they are based on non-nucleosides such as dorabirin, rilpivirin, or efavirenz, or in boosted PIs such as darunavir boosted or atazanavir boosted, or on a boosted integrase inhibitor, elvitegravir boosted. WHO has, as the only alternative regimen, the low dose of efavirenz, 400 milligrams, along with TDF and 3DC. 1.3 million is the estimated number of pregnant women living with HIV needing antiretrovirals in 2018.
If we ask ourselves which are the preferred ART regimens for non-pregnant women who are trying to conceive, we can see that the list shortens dramatically.
Both the European and the DHHS guidelines recommend raltegravir-based regimens, and the WHO recommends still the TDF plus 3DC FTC plus dolutegravir regimen, with the important footnote that the woman has to be fully informed of the potential risk of neural tube defects associated to taking dolutegravir during conception. Thanks to the CEPAMO study, we have now a very precise estimate of what is the risk of neural tube defects in women who take dolutegravir preconception. And the estimate has come down from 0.94% to 0.3% in the last estimate. So the risk is still significantly higher than for non-DTG containing regimens during conception, but it's small enough that women can make their own choice about if they prefer to use this regimen during pregnancy. And please be aware that tomorrow at this conference, there will be a very important update of this data from the CEPAMO study. Also, at CROI this year, we've seen the results of another important study, the IMPACT 2010 study, that have expanded our options for treatment of pregnant women. In this study, The randomization was for women who were beyond week 18 in their pregnancies, and they were randomized to receive dolutegravir, FTC, and TAF, tenofovir alafenamide, a drug for which we had very little information during pregnancy, dolutegravir, FTC, or TDF, or efavirenz, FTC, or TDF. Two important results: dolutegravir containing ART has superior virologic efficacy at delivery compared to the efavirenz regimen, and the arm included the new drug, TAF, FTC, dolutegravir, was associated with significantly fewer adverse pregnancy outcomes and fewer neonatal deaths than the efavirenz arm. So we have now a new drug, TAF, that can have more data about its role during pregnancy. But it's clear that we need more options for pregnant women since conception. The IDEA and the COHERE collaborations have estimated that 55% is the proportion of people living with HIV who start antiretroviral therapy with CD4 cell counts less than 200. As you can see in the slide, this varies geographically a lot. And when we look at the registrational clinical trials that have been performed during the last 12 years, you can see in the slide that we have very few data in these very advanced patients. Only the Artemis and the STARMARK study enrolled patients with baseline CD4 cell counts close to 200. The rest of the trials that have looked at the new drugs that are preferred guidelines enrolled participants with CD4 cell counts that were well above 350. It's only the REALITY trial performed in Africa that includes very advanced patients, but they didn't look at these new drugs. They look at NNRTI-based regimens with or without dolutegravir. So it's clear that we have a need of more data about optimal ART in advanced HIV infection. 1 million people living with HIV develop TB every year, and TB is the leading cause of death, admission to hospital, and in hospital death of people living with HIV. Which of the first line preferred regimens can be given along with rifampin in a patient for simultaneous treatment of TB? The answer is none. When we look at alternative regimens, the list is shortened completely to efavirenz-based regimens. We've looked at alternatives for efavirenz, and we have selected two drugs that, as you can see in the slide from the HIV Drug Interactions website, is raltegravir and dolutegravir that have a manageable interaction with rifampin, and these two drugs have been compared to efavirenz. Dolutegravir BID in the Aspirin trial saw promising results, but the sample size of this trial is limited, cannot compare to the wealth of data that we have with efavirenz for the simultaneous treatment of TB. And raltegravir BID, compared also with efavirenz in patients with TB, did not achieve non-inferiority in the RFLAIT-2 trial. If you want to dig deeper in the reasons why this non-inferiority was not met, go to see this oral presentation. So it's clear that there is a need also for alternatives for efavirenz in patients with TB. A modeling study has calculated that between 0.8 and 4.6 million will be the estimated number of patients receiving second-line ART in sub-Saharan Africa up to 2030. So in the last years, we've made great advances in the treatment of resistance HIV. One very important advance were the results of the Downing study that compare in participants who have failed first-line regimens based on NRTIs compared to recycled nucleosides plus dolutegravir versus two recycled nucleosides and lopinavir-ritonavir. And as you can see in the graph, the dolutegravir arm was superior to the lopinavir arm, and the DSMB has to stop the trial. The results of this study is the basis of the WHO recommendation of using dolutegravir along with two recycled nucleosides in patients who have failed a first-line non-dolutegravir-based regimen. And then we have, in the last 5 years, given many more drugs that have expanded our armamentarium against resistance HIV. I'm going to present briefly these drugs. All of them have in common that they belong to new classes, and they have mechanisms of actions that are different to current antiretrovirals, and for this reason, there is no cross resistance with existing antiretrovirals. First one is tenofovir. It's an attachment inhibitor. It's a small molecule that is given orally BID, binds to GP120, and as the study that appears in the slide shows, is highly efficacious against multi-drug resistance HIV infection. This drug can be gotten by a compassionate access program. We have also another attachment inhibitor, in this case not a small molecule, is a monoclonal antibody called ivalizumab, binds to the CD4 cell receptor, is long-acting, is administered IV every 2 weeks, have proven efficacy in a clinical trial of multi-drug resistance HIV, and is already approved by FDA and EMA. It's a costly drug, costs more than $100,000 per year. Another monoclonal antibody that is an attachment inhibitor is UB421, is also attached to the CD4 cell receptor. Monoclonal antibody, no drug interactions, is administered IV every 1 or 2 weeks, but there are work also in a subcutaneous formulation. There is a clinical trial ongoing of using this attachment inhibitor in combination with an optimized background regimen in patients with multi-drug resistance HIV. So another new class of drugs, nucleoside reverse transcriptase translocation inhibitors. The first representative of this class is called islatravir. This has different mechanisms of action. It's a chain terminator, but also inhibits RT by preventing translocation. As you can see in the slide, it's a very potent drug. Doses as low as 0.5 milligrams produce a profound impact on viral replication. And the other very important characteristic of this drug is its extremely long half-life of up to 160 hours that gives this drug the potential for weekly oral or even less frequent dosing. There is a trial ongoing of the combination of durvalumab and islatravir in heavily treatment-experienced patients. And if you want to see more data about this drug, go to see the two oral presentations that appear in the slide. New family of drugs, capsid inhibitors, first representative lenacapavir. As you can see in the slide, highly potent picomolar activity, also very long half-life. By subcutaneous injection, you can have sustained levels for more than 6 months. There is also an oral formulation, and there is a trial, the CAPELLA trial, ongoing, combining optimized background regimen plus lenacapavir in heavily treatment-experienced participants. And what is very striking is this drug, as in the maintenance period of this study, is giving us 900 milligrams once every 6 months. In the interest of time, I'm just going to mention three other options. One is leronlimab, a humanized monoclonal antibody. The target is CCR5 and is active against viruses resistance to maraviroc. It's administered IV or subcutaneously and can be given weekly or every 2 weeks. And we have a new fusion inhibitor, albuvirtide, that binds to GP41, can be given once weekly by intravenous infusion, but there is the possibility also of obtaining a long-acting subcutaneous formulation. And obviously, there is a lot of research on the role of broadly neutralizing antibodies for people with highly resistant virus. So we have in 2020 a lot of options for people living with HIV and resistance HIV. The big need is having global access to all these drugs. I recommend you also to go to this oral presentation about third line antiretroviral therapy in Africa. Investigators from Kaiser Permanente reported at this year's CROI that the expected number of comorbidity-free years at age 21 for a person living with HIV is 13.3 years. This is substantially shorter than the 29.3 years in an infected adult. So we have to have a big scrutiny on what is the impact of antiretroviral therapy on comorbidities, and also if the toxicities associated to antiretroviral therapy can impact comorbidities. And we have a bad track record of being very slow at detecting some toxicities of antiretrovirals. It took us 12 years to realize that ACT produces lipoatrophy. And with more recent drugs, such as dolutegravir, it took us 2 years to realize that some patients develop psychiatric effects. We have very safe drugs in the short term. This is one of my favorite examples. In this registrational trial, 314 participants who received bictegravir, FTC, and tenofovir lafenamide and were followed for 3 years, none, a single one of them stopped therapy due to adverse events. But this trial did not capture an adverse event that we have been discussing a lot for these last 2 years, is weight gain. In this meta-analysis that has been presented many times in the last 2 years from 8 randomized phase 3 clinical trials of different antiretrovirals, it's clearly that weight change is different depending on the drug. On the left panel, you can see that integrase inhibitors-treated participants gain more weight than PI-treated participants and more than participants treated with NNRTIs. In the middle panel, you can see that bictegravir and dolutegravir increase more weight than elvitegravir cobicistat. And on the right side panel, you can see that the increase of weight was even higher when participants didn't take abacavir, TDF, or cidobulin and took TAF. There are also an oral presentation at this conference looking at weight gain. So we have to add to our tables of toxicities recognized late this weight change with dolutegravir, bictegravir, and perhaps because it's not clear, increased weight gain with tenofovir alafenamide. NAMSAL study has also a presentation at this conference. So we have a big need to understand the importance and determinants of ART-induced weight changes and the impact of ART in other comorbidities. In Madrid, Dr. Berenger group looked at the prevalence of red flag drug-drug interactions among 23,000 people living with HIV, and the rate of these bad interactions was higher than 3%. It's true that since we have integrase inhibitors, non-boosted regimens, and we have new NRTIs such as rilpivirine or dorabirine, the risk of these interactions has lowered, but this is a permanent need to have ART with manageable interactions. Going back to economical theory, something is a want when non-fulfillment might result in disappointment, but there is an important caveat in the topic of antiretroviral therapy. Something could be a want or a need depending on the patient's circumstances. Kaiser Permanente investigators has also presented at CROI that the life expectancy at age 21 in the States, United States, for a person living with HIV is 55.5 years. So these are 5 decades of ART. So it's logical that patients that confront this extremely long period of treatment want less pills, less drugs, or no pills. We have 11 single pills, so the problem is not having them, it's access to all these single pills that encompass different antiretroviral classes. And there has been a lot of research in the last decade for designing regimens with less than 3 drugs, with the hypothesis that if you have to take drugs for 50 years, it's better to take less drugs than more drugs. And currently, we have a recommended regimen with only 2 drugs, dolutegravir and 3TC naive, and 2 recommended regimens in switch, dolutegravir 3TC and dolutegravir rilpivirine. We have alternatives based on boosted PIs along with a second drug, either 3TC or an integrase inhibitor such as raltegravir or dolutegravir. There is an important caveat for dual therapies, is that they do not cover chronic hepatitis B. Therefore, if you cannot test for hepatitis B surface antigen, you cannot use these drugs. And unfortunately, as the map shows, there is substantial overlap among countries that have a high incidence of HIV and a high incidence of chronic hepatitis B. There is a session at this conference devoted to hot topics in HIV therapy, and I'm covering 2 drug oral ART. And my summary for you is that after many years of searching, we right now have dual ART that matches the efficacy of triple drug antiretroviral therapy. It's also very important that we no longer need a booster to have dual therapies. But it's fair to recognize that we still don't know what are the long-term benefits of using dual therapy instead of triple therapy. And there are 2 very important questions to answer. One, is necessary to show that they improve outcomes or just by showing that you do the same job with one less drug is enough? And also, what is now the burden of the proof? More and more, I think, is in triple drug antiretroviral therapy that I think has to show that apart from covering hepatitis B, adding a second nucleoside improves very long-term outcomes. And what about no pills, not taking any pills? Is this a want or a need? Well, if the patient says, I just don't like pills, that can be considered a want. But if the patient has difficulty swallowing or absorbing, has risk with disclosures, doesn't want to take pills home, or taking pills every day increases internal or external stigma or difficulties with adherence, that can be considered a need. We have seen in the last 2 years that we have for the first time a long-acting combination of cabotegravir and rilpivirin. These two trials have proven beyond doubt that is non-inferior to triple drug oral ART with a very low risk of virologic failure. And at CROIT this year, the ATLAS-2M showed that the cabotegravir plus rilpivirin IM can be given every 2 months instead every 1 month. So this is a game changer for this combination. There are pros and cons with current long-acting injectables. The pros are less stigma, increased patient confidentiality, adherence, and potential for direct observed therapy. The cons is, as I mentioned, hepatitis B is not covered. We need a cold change for rilpivirin. We need oral lead-in and bridge regimens if the patient doesn't come back for the next shot. They have to be given by intramuscular injection, not self-administered. So this can have an impact on our busy clinics. They have a long pharmacokinetic tail. This can be an issue for resistance if patient, again, doesn't come back for the next shot, or in the case of toxicity. We still have to see what is the impact on injection site reaction when these patients are taking this drug for decades. And also with pregnancy, zero data about the safety of these combinations in women who become pregnant, and also the issue of cost. Be ready for the second generation of long-acting antiretroviral therapy with some of the drugs I've mentioned in my talk, with lenacapavir, islatravir, also with broadly neutralizing antibodies or combinectin, and also the big issue of implants that can be given even less frequently. So in summary, what are the needs or wants in 2020 for antiretroviral therapy? First and foremost, global access to ART, and at least in low and middle income countries, rapid start. More options for pregnant and wishing to conceive women. More options for simultaneous treatment of HIV and tuberculosis. Having more data about what is the optimal ART in advanced disease. Having global access to treatment for resistance HIV. Better understanding about the relationship of ART and comorbidities, and especially weight gain, the persistent need of ART with manageable interactions, understanding the role of 2D ART in the long term, made our patients' life simpler by single pills or long-acting antiretroviral therapy. Let me finish in by acknowledging the colleagues in my HIV unit at Hospital La Paz in Madrid, Spain, and Anton Pozniak, Jürgen Rockstroth, Sharon Wamsley, Federico Pulido, and José Luis Narro for his continuous support. And to my wife, Carmen Bayon, that I've shared many things with her, but I've never shared preparing a plenary talk at home. Thank you very much for your attention.